Welcome to Don't Drink and Review. I'm Tanner Purtis. Today I am joined by Matt, the amazing musician from No Refills. How you doing today?
Doing good, thank you.
Awesome. So let's get right into it. We have these sweet beers by Rare Form Brewing Company. They are based out of, this one's Chattanooga. I love that name. That one had a different place that it was shipped from, but they're from New York. So what one do you want to try first?
I think we gotta go IPA into Mexican lager.
Okay.
I think that's right. The only way.
Let's do it. So this one's an IPA. It's called Troy Division.
It's got a sick can.
It's beautiful.
Look at that.
Yeah. I like these new like designer cans. It's like that's a big part of the beer now for me. I'm like, oh, if it doesn't look cool, I'm not gonna drink it.
This label looks stupid.
Right? It definitely doesn't taste good.
The amount of bad
good.
Beers I've drank just because the can looks cool, though.
Exactly.
Like, I'm going to buy that. Oh, it's awful.
Yeah, they spend a little bit too much time on the art and not the beer.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to try and not fuck this up.
Live pours.
I know. This is like, ooh, look at that. Look at it. It's like cloudy. It's almost like a hazy.
Yeah, that's what I'm expecting that to be.
It's definitely like, it almost looks like orange juice. All right. Dead air. Okay, we're gonna give a little head for these. Tyler, get in here, grab some.
Oh, look at that perfect head. There we go.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, and it's growing.
Damn.
Spoke too soon.
Wow, it was so close, too.
Okay, here, you can have this one. Cheers, boys.
Cheers, man.
Cheers. Okay. It's got a great aroma, like when I was drinking it, it's got almost like a peachy, like it's definitely got some.
It's a lot sweeter than I was expecting.
Yeah, that's why I was like, I feel like this is more of a hazy kind of IPA. It's got some fruit in it for sure. It's not bad.
It looks like a hazy, but I don't taste the citrus in it.
It's got something. It's pretty good. I like it.
It's very drinkable.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I'm picky with my beer, so they did well with this one.
So we're going to be talking about the new Space Jam movie today. I grew up watching Space Jam. It was like one of my favorite movies, and like I couldn't watch it at home because like my parents were so strict with so many different kinds of movies. So there was a certain babysitter that I would go to. And they had
a cool babysitter,
right? And they had Space Jam. And I was like, oh, I want to watch that one. So I really fell in love with the original. But this new one, so I went into it with like this anticipation of that it's going to be good, you know, because I was like, I liked the last one. I think the story is fun, and so I had high expectations going into this one, but like. Me personally, the movie fell so short. There was a lot of cool parts, but like the thing that I have noticed with a lot of new movies these days is it's just like they're it's like all focused on visual, and it's there's not enough like actual
character development's the big one for me.
Right.
These character arcs just are not happening anymore, and everyone is a two-dimensional character.
Right.
It's rare to see them break from that. Like they found a mold that works and they just stick to it.
Right.
Kind of thing.
Right. And so like with the start of this movie, it just kind of like I knew exactly what was going to happen. They set up this relationship and had this relationship dynamic between LeBron and his son. And I was like, "Oh, so that's the key of this movie." But
yeah, it's going to be family tied.
Right. And I guess in the original, they had like a little bit of a character development before they actually jumped into the actual storyline. I mean, they did, like, they foreshadowed it a little bit with the aliens at the beginning, but, like, there was none of that. It was just like, okay, LeBron's awesome. He's a basketball player, and then he's a shitty dad, and then let's go.
Yeah, like they gave LeBron his backstory through those opening credits with all the shots of him growing up and everything, and that little tiny opening scene of him, getting chewed out for playing on his Game Boy.
And then he throws it away.
Then they go straight into the actual movie, whereas, and I could be wrong about this, I felt like the original Space Jam, they just dove right on in and were like, all right, let's go. But same thing, opening credits, you just saw a lot of plays Michael Jordan playing with the Bulls, and like it was a very similar mirrored intro.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Especially like young Jordan, young LeBron playing, and then you get to see them, like you get to see the prime or whatever, like all the snapshots and stuff. But the thing that I liked about the original is that like Michael Jordan wasn't like this hero. Like I feel like in this one, like they just put LeBron on this like pedestal. He's like, he's the shit. They didn't really kind of like bring him down to humanity. Like he wasn't relatable. He's like, oh, I'm this rich basketball star. And I don't know. I liked the way that they set up Michael Jordan in the other one. He's like, it's kind of silly. Like he's playing baseball and he's kind of like down and out. Mm-hmm. But like LeBron, he's like, oh, I'm the best basketball player, and of course I'm going to make my son a basketball player, and fuck video games. And it was like,
How?
Yeah.
Right. I know that you guys after games go and play NBA and everything. Like I know you guys are into it. You can't hate it that much.
Right.
I tried so hard to not compare LeBron to Michael. Like the whole time I was watching this, it was like, hey, I'm not going to compare the acting. Both of them were terrible.
Oh yeah.
I'm going to look at the movie itself, the writing, and just see how'd you bring this into modern day. And that's really, I went into it with actually expectations of this is gonna be the worst movie ever. Mm. I'm gonna walk out of this thinking I just wasted 2 hours of my life. I'm never getting those back.
Do you think that's a better way to go into a movie like that?
Most movies I go into thinking, like, I have all my theories as to what I want to happen.
Right.
And then when it doesn't go my way, I'm really happy and excited. Whereas when it goes my way, I'm let down because I'm like, I already predicted all this. Like, this isn't fun for me. You know, this is what I would have done. And I like being caught off guard. And Space Jam, I mean, you're going into a fun family movie.
Right.
You know, it's a comedy. It's got a little tiny bit of action and sports. But, like, you can't go in there expecting a good story. So it was more of like, I'm going to assume this is going to be a dumpster fire. It's going to be terrible with the acting. There's going to be no development, everything like that. And I think because I went in with that expectation, I was caught off guard and I really enjoyed it. I think it was better than the original one, which is going to be a very unpopular opinion.
Really?
I think that comparing the two actors, I mean, essentially they're very, very similar. They're both not very good at acting, but you could see the effort. You know, they wanted to do it and they had fun. You could see it, you know, on screen a few times with both of them. And I went out of my way. I watched the original the day before the new one came out. So I wanted that comparison.
Nice.
Because I knew going in, this is going to be a LeBron versus Michael comparison. Yeah. It doesn't matter what the movie is.
Right.
Yeah.
I did it the opposite way. I watched the old one afterwards and I was just already so jaded and I was like, this is so much better. And like, so yeah, that's interesting to me that you thought this one was better. I guess me personally, I like the old one because it was more funny to me. Like they kept jabbing at Michael. Mm-hmm. And like in this one, it's like everybody just sucks up to LeBron.
Yeah, they were like afraid to give him any. Yeah.
Right. And it was like, okay, so like, yeah, obviously he's this superhero, but like bring him down. Like let's make him relatable. And I guess they did that with him being a shitty dad, but like, I don't know. Like I want them to be able to poke fun.
Cliche story arc kind of thing. Watch the dad become a better dad. You know, it's like,
And that's like it, that you knew exactly how it was going to play out too. Mm-hmm. Right from the beginning. I'm like, okay, so him and his son are going to get into confrontation over obviously video games. And I mean, I guess they had to do that because like the thing with this one is, this is a kid's movie for kids today. Mm-hmm. And like, what kid today watched Looney Tunes?
Well, the thing, they had a challenge, though, of our audience, people our age who have seen the original and grew up with that, are going to compare the two, of course, no matter what. Like, you're going to have that. And we want the nostalgia. That's what we go into that film wanting, the nostalgic 90s feel. Whereas kids, they want the entertainment. They want to, you know, they want the new technology, which is why that video game aspect of it made a lot of sense. And I think just comparing the two, the demographics that they were reaching out to, they had a lot more they had to do to please the audience this time.
Right.
It wasn't a first time that they've done this. And one of the things that really stuck out to me was that they kept making fun of the original. It happens a few times, like, oh, you know, this is a once in the lifetime opportunity to play with an NBA star. And there's like little lines like that where it's right. like, is this a sequel or are you just kind of taking the piss out of the old one? Like, what, right. what's really going on here?
Yeah,
and it's like only the Looney Tunes knew that it was a sequel and everyone else, it was like a standalone. I thought that was kind of cool.
I did notice that. There was one line that Bugs is like, well, he says something like last time. He says it was something last time. And I was like, oh, that was pretty good. That was, I liked that. I enjoyed that. So what did you think about the way, like the first half of the movie when they go into, you know, the cyberverse or whatever. I what did you think about that first half of the movie?
The immediate reaction is, oh, this is stupid and unbelievable.
Right.
But you have to look at the original one as well, which unfortunately you have to do. And in the original one, you get to the Looney Tunes world and you just dig a hole in the ground. And it's like, okay, just
right.
dig down and all of a sudden you're in this new world. Whereas
right.
at least here, even though the whole server verse was a little bit of a stretch,
yeah,
it at least like you went into the world a different way in a little bit more of a believable way, like
right.
something modern that, you know, technology driven. Whereas obviously you're not just going to dig a hole and find a completely different world. So
right.
both of them not believable, but I kind of like that they used the technology to their advantage and were like, hey, let's create our world within this world and do it in a way that kind of could be real. And obviously there's people who think that we're in a computer simulation right now.
Right.
So it kind of appeases those people as well.
Right.
That was the big difference there, though. It's like, if you want to compare one being believable over the other, do you want to take the hole in the ground or do you want to take the technology?
Right. I really like that lane where it's like they tried to really stick with modern times. The thing that I had a problem with because nobody gives a shit about Looney Tunes, about those characters. I mean, like,
I didn't realize they've started redoing it again.
Like they have?
Yeah, it's airing again, apparently. I had no idea.
Wow.
Like, okay, maybe this will boost it a little bit.
That's probably why. They're like, oh, we're going to release Space Jam, and then people are going to be like, oh, let's... Because, mm-hmm. honestly, I loved the Looney Tunes. I loved the way their characters were. Like, I think in this movie, too, they lost a little bit of that, like, personality that these characters have. Like, Bugs wasn't as, like... smart. He was more like,
I think if you take Bugs out of the question, it was spot on. Bugs had his own personality though in this one,
and
he was a little different.
Right, he's my favorite, so I would agree, because like Daffy, he was still just the same dumb.
Marvin the Martian was perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Got his popular lines in that.
Yeah,
when he came on screen, that was the first time I smiled and was like, I'm gonna enjoy this
right.
is gonna be fun,
right?
Because up until that point it was like, no, what are you guys doing, what are you doing, this is gonna be awful. And then they finally hit the mark. I was like, okay, I see where this is going now.
Right.
And then it was great up until they decided to...
The story started?
...update the Looney Tunes into whatever the hell that was.
Right, right. And you know what I didn't like, too, is that they cartoonized LeBron.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, just keep him...
I thought it was cool how they did that. And like the Mad Max scene, how he's back to, you know, real LeBron. Like I thought it was clever.
Right. I thought it was interesting, too, to kind of... I think they did this to, like, gather, like, attention and, like, familiarities. They put in all those old, like, not old movies, but, like, these modern movies that everybody has seen because of the fact that, like, Looney Tunes is kind of dated. So it's, like, it was cool that they, like, put all that in, but I think they needed to do that to, like, actually make this movie ingestible for the
mm-hmm.
young crowd.
Well, and to try to get it away from being a two-hour Warner Brothers ad. Because, like, at the end of the day, all it was one giant ad for all their different, you know, products, their different movies, things like that. Like,
yeah.
That essentially is what we saw. It was like, hey, look, we've done all this great stuff. Go watch it.
Right.
A lot of the story felt that way.
Yeah, but well, because there wasn't really, like, the story didn't even start until they, like, made it into... until they started playing basketball, essentially. It was like,
for me, it was when they got on Marvin's ship is when the story started. Up until then, it was like, we're going to give you backstory that you don't care about.
Right.
And then we're going to start this film.
Right. And it even then, it felt like it was just like, they were just like throwing stuff together until they actually got to like the conflict of the story, which I mean, I put my standards so high because I'm like, oh, I love this. Like, I want this
difference, and we seem to have met halfway.
Yeah, right. Let's see here. I'm trying to think. What was your favorite part of the movie?
Lola, her Wonder Woman scene, it becoming an Amazon, was hands down the best thing that they could have done there. Like, you took this character who, based off the trailers, I was pissed off that they changed her so much. I was right. Like, oh, you did her dirty. Like,
her
she just doesn't look
huge.
Right.
Yeah.
And then you got that scene, which was, it was like watching, you know, something out of a comic book movie, which obviously is what they were going for.
Right.
But not, you know, not a live action. They were going for that, like, you know, more traditional feel. And I thought that had the most wow factor of, this is different. This is cool. I haven't seen this before.
Yeah.
And that really made up for a lot of that whole montage of collecting the different tunes. That made
yes.
up for it and was kind of like the core moment of, okay, this was, I like what they did here. This was a good idea.
Yeah, I agree. I did like that spot. I don't like what they did with her, like, look. Like, even her face was, it was too,
it seemed off.
She had like tons of makeup, like she had blush on, and like,
it was like they were caught between trying to make her, for some reason, an attractive character versus a cute, fun kids character, and they just couldn't find which route they wanted to go.
Right.
So they tried to like do both.
Right, because
like can't do that.
Because they kept the main core like personality, like she's the badass woman that's like better than all the other toons, mm-hmm. the most talented actual character. But then like in the original, she's like, you know, they try to make her super hot.
Yeah.
You know?
What?
Yeah, so there definitely was like, I do like how they kind of kept the personalities of the characters. I think the only one that bothered me the most was the Bugs Bunny. His yeah. character wasn't as crafty.
We expect so much from him that they fell short, and it was just like, you know, you could have gone this route or that route.
Right.
And he kind of gave up on the other Looney Tunes and LeBron partway through the movie.
Yeah.
I was like, this is not like Bugs. You're supposed to be all in all the time. You know, this is different.
Yeah. And let's see.
Anything to push the plot line though, right?
Yeah, seriously. And I just don't, there wasn't enough like contention, you know, like when Algorithm and the Sun are working together, he's just kind of oblivious to what's going on. I wish they kind of would have made him more like agitated.
Yeah, they dumbed the kid down a little
right.
bit. And I was like, come on, this is predictable. You should see what's going on.
Right, because instead of making like LeBron and Algorithm, their fight essentially, like yeah. it's a fight between them. It's like they should have had I wish they would have had more depth of fighting between LeBron and his son, because it was just like that. Mm-hmm. They just like made up it, but it was
yeah,
like,
and all of a sudden, oh, let's go to half court and we're friends again.
Right. It was like there was no real stake to have. The only reason they had the son there is so that they can have like.
It was just to push the video game.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what I felt anyway.
Yeah.
It was like, hey, let's push this different. You know, let's bring in this audience who likes video games, is into
right.
E3 and all this stuff, and. Let's welcome them into basketball and try to get them involved as well, which I get it. I just think they fell short of making it believable.
Right, because like he was so just wishy-washy. The kid was mm-hmm. just like, oh, this is just a game. And it's like, you know, maybe make the fight more intense. Maybe make the conflict a little bit deeper than just like Algorithm. And because I never really understood what Algorithm's problem was, like, why was he so like just
wanted
what,
to be more liked? Yeah, he
right
didn't,
what was the point of LeBron being there?
Two-dimensional characters of there's no real reason for you to be like the way you are, other than LeBron just turned down your idea.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh,
work
yeah.
on a better one.
Right. He called it. What did he say? I can't remember what he said. But yeah, that was like. I guess that's right. That was the only point. And he's like, well, then I'm gonna kill everybody. Like,
we just trap everyone in here.
Yeah. Like.
And then
what?
With all due respect, the original one also villain had no reason other than, hey, I want to take over this world. Like, this is
right.
gonna be mine now. I want to own this.
Right. Well, no. Even in the original one, what Michael Jordan is trying to save the Looney Tunes. They're mm-hmm. getting taken away.
Yeah.
So it's like, there was a little bit more of like there's a little bit more at stake. Well, I guess I mean everybody's there. So like they downloaded everybody to this server, and everybody's gonna be stuck there. So there's a lot of stake going on, but like
it's like LeBron had less to lose. Right. It was really he was losing himself originally, anyway, until they built that new algorithm to bring all the real people into the film. But like until then, it was just LeBron was either going to win or he was going to be stuck.
Right.
Whereas Michael Jordan, it was like you're going to lose Looney Tunes if he lost. So it was a different stakes.
Right. And yeah. It kind of puts him on like this pedestal of like, oh, he's like a good, he's the savior, he's a hero. But like LeBron, he's not even really a hero. I wish they would have, like I said before, I wish they would have made it more stake between him and his son.
Mm-hmm.
Like win back your son's love instead of like, I mean, he kind of did when he was like, oh, using the power-ups and starts to learn the game and like recognizes his talent. But it's like, make the stakes higher. I mean, like, yeah. I guess how all these people's
still
lives.
Sports movie.
Right. True. I just expect so much out of high budget films like that. Cause like, obviously they spent a shitload of money on this. Like,
which leads into my biggest problem with the movie is that they have the big court scenes, right? You know, you got the final game and they did a really cool thing bringing King Kong and like Adam West's Batman and all these cool characters in.
Right.
But I'm sorry, you're spending a ton of money on this movie and you can't even make it look like they're watching the game. Like it was like they were all on a loop and none of them were working together or looked like they were playing the part.
Yeah.
And it was like, You could have made this more fun by having these characters, you know, these like Easter eggs, if you want to call them that, these cameos,
a movie full of Easter eggs,
of making it look right instead of like the Penguin, the Danny DeVito version of Penguin. You could see like the lines on the head mask that they put on to do his hair, and it's like you're Warner Brothers. You could have paid someone to fix that. You know, like how much money does it cost to put a proper wig on him?
Yeah,
and make
seriously.
This look real instead of, you know, something I could have put together on Photoshop.
Right. And I think they had to do that because there wasn't a lot actually going on, like, other than, like, it's just a basketball game.
They assume the audience is going to focus on the players. But you have people like me, I'm watching it for the nostalgia.
Right.
So I'm looking at the background characters and the Easter eggs and the things that are fun for me. And it fell short because of that. Is like, just put a little bit more love into it. And, and they would have really shined.
Because really, that's what, like, they were playing basketball, and it's like, that's exactly what I was doing. I was like, oh, look, that's that character.
Yeah.
It's,
oh, cool, they brought Robin in.
Yeah. He did something really funny. He was just doing, like, this flexing thing. I'm like, did you just let him do whatever he wanted? Like, I don't know. I feel like he should have been a little bit more cheesy.
Yeah, I'm curious what those extras, like, what were they given as far as material? Hey, just go out there and watch and, you know, do some faces? Or were they, you know, were they just all green screened in? Yeah. How did they work that?
Right. Like
in?
You it said, was... like nobody's actually watching the game. They're all just kind of like there, like being ominous. Like there's the villain side and everybody's just kind of like ominous. And then like everybody else is just like, well, this is crazy. So, I mean, I did enjoy watching it, but like I feel I wanted more. I wanted more out of this movie.
It's entertaining, but nothing you can fall in love with. Like nothing where you can be like, oh, they did this right. And yeah, it was just like they failed on the nostalgia part because that seems to be where they cheaped out.
Yeah.
They spent a lot of money on parts that didn't matter, and then they cheaped out on the parts, at least to me personally, that mattered to me, the things I wanted to see.
Right.
And like, had they not done the entire 2D, the middle of the movie was the best thing. The meat of the movie was great.
Yeah.
Like I thoroughly enjoyed it, but as soon as they started playing the final game, fell off track. The intro to the movie, barely even kept my attention.
Right.
Whereas like the other Space Jam, the intro was okay, but it got better throughout the film. You got more engaged in with the character development. This one just, halfway through the movie, you didn't care anymore.
Right.
As much fun as it was for those, you know, 20, 30 minutes, it was like the movie was over for me when the game started.
Yeah.
And I lost interest.
Right, because like even then, like once it comes to fruition, it was just like, okay, like the movie's over and here we are. Nothing's really changed. There's no like, everything's essentially the same other than like now LeBron is okay with his son playing video games. Like,
nothing quite changed, but now you can go do E3 instead of basketball. We're fine with that.
Right? Which,
you know,
I'm
get
curious
it. From like a gamer perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So original Space Jam comes out, I had only known hockey. And that was the one sport I followed in, you know, even for the following years, but that movie opened my eyes up to basketball and allowed me to watch it and start to enjoy it and practice it and play, you know. I'm curious for the gamers, because that's the only thing I can really compare it to, or people who weren't familiar with basketball, if it did the same thing for them, if it made them excited to go play. And I'm curious to see in the next few months if it does go that way, if more people are interested in the sport now.
I don't think
they will be.
I don't think so, because like they didn't even make it. It was definitely like more of like a video game kind of play, because it was like they didn't even make it that interesting of a basketball game. It was more of like
quick and brushed.
Yeah, and it was like, oh, look at all these cool powers. I didn't even really enjoy like the villain side. Like you got to see a little bit of development of the villains in
Monstars over the Goon Squad all day.
Oh, every
Monsters
day.
Were way better.
Yeah, like, they're funny too.
Yeah, they looked like basketball players. They didn't have a spider randomly playing basketball. Like, I get what you're going for. You're trying to bring technology in, but it's not fun.
I really wish too that they would have had better actors. There was not that many like solid. Like in the original, there's Bill Murray. There's, I can't think of the guy's name with the glasses.
Who basically replaced Bill Murray.
Wayne Knight. Oh yeah, he's hilarious. Like they were the ones that were carrying the acting, because like obviously Michael Jordan can't act.
Yeah, they made up.
Obviously
for it.
LeBron can't act, but they kept having like these other characters that also could not act. So it was like, I think you need to have a little bit more talent in there instead of just like superstars.
Yeah, I mean, you know? I think where they disconnected from the audience there is the original one, they didn't use the basketball, like, what is it, Muggsy Bogues? Like, they didn't use his personality for his character on the Monstars.
Yeah.
Whereas for the Goon Squad, they used the personality and the acting of those basketball players.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's just not as fun. Like, you guys could have had a lot more fun with it. Yeah, still use those skins, if you want to call them that. You know, still use what you wanted to use, but put actors in who are good and can you know, play those parts and make it believable, because you have to make up for the lack of acting from LeBron. Like, you the whole movie, you have to make up for that.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, they only had, I mean, arguably the only good actor, Algorithm, what's his name? Chad?
Don Cheadle?
Oh, Don, yeah, he was great.
Other than his random robotic voice that they added, which
I kind of liked it. It had like this ominous
feel. I get
feel.
What they were doing,
right?
But it was laughable. And I guess like appealing to a kid audience, yeah, it works. It's funny. Right. But for me, it was just like, oh, you guys are trying too hard.
Well, and it didn't fit his persona didn't really change when that voice came in. Cause like you would think they would get like more like darker, more angry, mm-hmm. but like his face really didn't change much.
Yeah.
It was just
similar.
His voice. So yeah, there's a lot of things that like I wish. There's a lot of things that I definitely would change, but obviously, like, you know, it's supposed to be this kind of like fast food movie for everybody.
Yeah. No, it did. Like I was saying earlier, just a giant advertisement is really what it was. But there's nothing wrong with that. You can get away with it. I mean, look at every Marvel movie we're watching right now. They're all basically promotions of the next movie.
True.
Like, how can we use this movie to promote the next one? And that's what this felt like, is how can we promote the next big Warner Brothers movie?
Right.
And like, a big thing I was thinking of is like, okay, obviously COVID delayed this film.
Right.
It delayed a lot of stuff. Why didn't you use that time to get your producers and your, I feel awful not having the real name, but like your animators, give them the time to work on the development of like those back scenes, those background characters, have them play with it a little bit more.
Right.
You had the time.
Or yeah, like what you're saying with the villains, like the bad basketball team, the Goon Squad. There was like they could have added more emotions to the face, or like I don't know how that works. I'm sure they do some kind of like where they wear those suits, so they actually do some of the movement. But it's like put some more effort into that. They're all like straight faced.
Was it Antonio Davis? I think not a big basketball person, so sorry if I got that wrong.
Yeah,
but other than his character, who was it? Brow, I think they called him. He was great. It was perfect. The other, was it four of them? Were just kind of, like this, you're not really an interesting character. I don't care about this snake running around the court or the spider.
Yeah.
Which, thank you, Lola, for calling her a worm. That was the biggest laugh for me the entire movie was hearing that. Get out of here, you worm.
Yeah, and I'm glad that they did keep kind of the silly comedy, like slapstick comedy with the Looney Tunes, because like that's what they are. Like it's dumb funny, but it's like dumb clever funny.
It's dad joke funny.
Yeah, and I like it. I liked it a lot. I wish they would have used the I can't think of who he was, but that time the time
like Kronos or something like that.
Oh yeah, Kronos. That was his name. Yeah, I wish they would have like they used him twice. I'm like, he was your. Why did you bench him the whole game? I don't get that. Like.
You have an interesting character who's way better than the other goons, and you just put him in all of a sudden. That was an interesting move.
Yeah. Well, let's try this next beer. What do you think?
Yes, beer time.
Confetti. Mexican style lager.
I feel like confetti is an interesting name for a Mexican beer.
Right. Like, maybe like Fiesta?
Yeah, Fiesta or at this sound bad, Piñata. I don't know. Something.
Oh, that would have been cool, Piñata. Oh, let's see.
Let's see if there's a reason for it.
Get in here. Okay. So this one, like I said, it's a lager, Mexican lager. We'll
get this
see.
This debris out of here.
Yeah, right. Can't contaminate.
I don't want to taste that in there.
Wow, look how much lighter that one is. Holy cow.
Yeah, all that cloudiness is gone.
That's crazy. I was expecting a little bit more color.
Still from New York. And I've never had a beer from New York, at least not knowingly. And so far, I've been happy. Let's see if, second time works as well.
Well, I think the thing with, like,
I'm a
New
big
York,
Northwest beer person.
I think the thing with that area, too, is that, like, there is so much saturation. Like, there's probably hundreds and hundreds of breweries in New York that's, like, you kind of have to step your game up if everybody else is doing it.
That's
you
how
know
I felt
I mean?
In Seattle. It was like every corner had a different brewery on it.
Or coffee.
And they're all specialty breweries too. Like you don't have like the typical ones. And yeah, beer tasting in Seattle is completely different. I like, for example, I always hated IPAs. And then I moved to Seattle and realized, oh, these are my favorite beers. They just have to be done properly.
Right. And yeah, that's so true. Because like, I used to not like, I used to like light beers. I used to like, you know, shitty gas station beers, and then I've had a couple good IPAs, and I was like, damn, like, this is where it's at. It's, like, actual depth of flavor. It's not just, like, alcohol water.
It kind of tastes like a Tecate.
Oh, it does. Mmm. I like that. Not bad.
What's something else in there that I can't quite figure out? It might just be the end of the IPA that I just had.
No, it kind of has like a malty, like the end of it is kind of like a, like not chocolatey, but like rich.
Yeah, it's got something right at like that aftertaste. Mm-hmm. It hangs out with you for quite a while.
Yeah. I like the other one better for sure.
More my style beer.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, right.
As far as Mexican lagers go, well done.
Yeah, yeah. Like I could drink this like if I was, you know, partying or something and wanted to drink a larger amount of alcohol, this would be a nice one to just keep drinking on.
I feel like this would be a great, I'm at a sports bar drinking this on tap kind of beer.
That's
kind of what I'm already picturing.
Ooh, almost have to pee a little bit. That's okay. We're going to hold that. So,
I'll keep the conversation exciting.
Yeah, right? I'm just going to bounce my legs. Let's see. My favorite part of the new Space Jam,
Do you think LeBron or Michael did it better?
I think Michael did it better.
Just because you like Michael more?
I've never been like super into basketball. So like I don't really have skin in the game either way, but I guess I don't know Michael as well either.
Michael was like a pop star to the world though.
Right.
It was a different level than LeBron.
And the thing that I liked about in just the movie itself is they were taking shots at Michael the whole time. It was just like chomping at him. And I loved that because it's like, yeah, like if you can't make fun of yourself, then what are you doing? But like in the new one with LeBron, they weren't taking shots at him at all. It was like there was no...
I've been trying, since you brought it up, I've been trying to find something where they did pick him apart, and I can't find anything. Like, looking back at it, I don't remember anything that really was like a jab to him or some kind of way to roast him. Whereas, yeah, with Michael, it was pretty constant.
Yeah, it was like the whole time they were making fun of him. The toons were making fun of him. And it's like, in this... That's the thing that I don't enjoy. It's like, if you're going to be in a Looney Tunes movie, they're always talking shit on each other. They're always like... bringing each other down and then back up, but it's like let the writing make him more human, make him more take jabs at him, because obviously
take him from being a superstar, make him a character in a movie,
right? Because he felt just like LeBron probably is in real life. He's like, he's not approachable. You basically have to like worship him or else he'll be mean to you. You know what I mean? Like,
suck
that's how
up
I
to
feel.
Him or he'll just I don't care.
That's how I feel. Like, he'll treat me like he does his son. You know? I'm like, come on.
Well, so, I think one thing that might have affected that is Michael hated being in the spotlight. He absolutely hated it. And I'm curious if that at all did reflect on the big screen, that like LeBron wanted that. He likes to be front and center. And to me, it looked like he was trying harder than he needed to. And I'm very curious. There was one scene that stuck out to me where it was him and his son kind of having their coming together party on the court. And like, I couldn't tell if he was trying to act and failed or if he was really tearing up and trying to hide it because of his masculinity. Like, I had to rewind and watch it again when the movie ended. I was like, is this him acting? Because if so, like, it's not that bad. Or is he just straight up so afraid to like get into the movie and be critiqued on it that he was fighting back an emotion that could have been really good there?
Right.
Because that scene was almost believable.
Is that the one like when they're like at the end, not at the very end, but like when they win the game and like they kind of come together or something like that?
Yeah, like him and I don't remember if it was right after halftime before like his son switches over to his team or if it was after that, but they have like this little coming together party where they, you know, he's talking about how proud he is and all this and like, you could see it on his face. Like, something hit LeBron emotionally. Like something happened there. And he either fought it or he was trying to push it further. And then it turned into this unbelievable, like, oh, this just doesn't work.
I think I remember that. And
it was close, though.
I think I like your take on it is that he was feeling real emotions in the moment. He was becoming an actor because that's what you do as an actor. Like, you put yourself in that moment, and that's why those emotions can come out and they feel real, because like you're actually feeling those emotions. And I think you're right. I think he started actually feeling that like real sadness, because I do remember there was a part where he like, you can hear it in his voice.
His voice goes up a little bit. Yeah, like it starts to crackle and you're like, are you acting or is this real and you're hiding it? Because if it's real and you're hiding it, fuck you.
Yeah,
like,
seriously.
Let me have that. You had a moment here that was going to be good.
Because that was probably the best acting of the entire, if it was, that was like his best actual performance, because there was like a little bit of emotion. Yeah. There was like a tiny touch. Yeah,
he felt real for a glimpse and then it went away.
Yeah.
And I personally, just watching it, looked like he was fighting back.
Right. I like that.
And
take.
I think it was a masculinity issue. I really do. I think he just didn't want to be brought down to that level and be humanized almost.
Right.
You know? He didn't want to be taken off his pedestal, like you were saying.
The thing that I see with LeBron, and like, I'm obviously like, I'm not a basketball guy. I don't really follow the dude's story, but it always seems like he wants the crown. He wants to be
the king.
He wants to be named the best. And the difference between him and Michael is Michael was given the crown. People like, obviously he went for it, but like,
I think Michael wanted to be the best to be the best.
Right.
Whereas LeBron wants to be the best for the stardom.
He just,
and
yeah, that, he
that's
wants
just
to be,
what I feel. And
he
I could
wants
be wrong.
To be recognized as the GOAT, but it's like, you don't get to just like, that is given to you. You can't just be like, I'm the GOAT. You know what I mean?
I'm realizing they did take some shots at LeBron. When they were talking about the Cavaliers and the Heat and the Lakers, of like, who's it going to be next? You know, what team do you play for?
Right.
That is the one thing they did take a couple little shots at him.
Right, but I guess that's the only thing that they could do is kind of attack his career. But like, I wish they would have taken more shots, because that's
it's
one
just
of the...
a different league now where players are being traded around a lot more. Like Michael Jordan was the face of the Bulls, and LeBron, unfortunately, has been moved around so much that you don't really relate him. Like, Cleveland, I guess, but you don't really relate him to a team anymore.
Right. Well, and like, who would you say is a better player altogether? Because like, obviously they've both had incredible careers, but if you were to compare them, not like a one-on-one, like, because obviously the league is different now.
Yeah,
but like,
and you have an age gap.
Who do you think is better?
So, there's two ways to look at it.
Mm-hmm.
I think LeBron has a little bit more talent, and he's got obviously the game's changed. He's got technology, different shoes, different things that make him look and feel better.
Right.
But Michael had such raw talent his work ethic was unlike anything.
Right.
That if you were to put the two against each other, and I know it's never going to happen, I do think Michael is better in that sense.
Right.
And he's been less selfish on the court, and he's there to make his teammates better.
Right.
Whereas LeBron just wants that spotlight. He wants to be the number one player on the court every single night. And I think that's where you differentiate the two is on a team. Yeah, LeBron lets his team down because of that. You know, right. He's not going to pass the ball as much. Whereas when Michael figured out how to win, he never stepped back. He didn't mind scoring less if it meant winning.
Right.
He was all about winning. LeBron's all about putting up the numbers and putting up the stats.
Right.
And it's hard to tell who's going to be better or worse. Like, right. I think it's a hard comparison.
I would say athletically, I think LeBron has it just because, like you said, like modern technology, like
yeah.
He as like
more athletic
raw athletics go, I think he could probably like if it was like based on stamina and like new technical aspects, but like you said, I think Michael has more of he's got more of a drive, he's got mm-hmm. more of this like desire to win instead of be like the spotlight. But I mean, that being said, like the sport wouldn't be what it is without Michael Jordan.
Oh, so yeah, it's like, not at all. I mean, Michael Jordan took a hockey fan, made me a basketball fan for several years until, unfortunately, the Suns traded for Shaquille O'Neal. And that was when I stopped watching basketball.
Yeah.
But that's its own thing. But no, like, Michael brought me into a sport that, in the household I was in, like, I had no reason to watch basketball.
Same.
Like, I watched American football and hockey. Those were my sports.
Like, same. Yeah, I agree, because like I do remember when I was a kid watching Space Jam and being like, oh, basketball's awesome. Like, I wasn't into basketball. And like, I don't feel like this Space Jam has anything like that. It doesn't like...
It didn't have the I want to be like Mike atmosphere.
Yeah, it's like nobody wants to be like LeBron. Yeah. He's like this monotone.
Yeah, he's a little bit whiny. And...
Yeah, like everybody hates me and I'm a bad dad. And like, it's just... He's just not relatable. And I wish they could have just... do something to like either give him like a nice sidekick that makes him seem more silly.
What would be LeBron's Bill Murray, do you think?
Because
obviously they missed that mark.
Yeah,
big time.
They should have. Okay,
like who could you have thrown in there to make up? Obviously, like, it's hard to change Bill Murray with anyone.
Like, I wish they would have like put a comedian in there, because that's mm-hmm. what they did. They put a comedian in there to kind of like lighten up the mood. Kevin Hart. Throw Kevin Hart in the mix.
I mean, then they even had a laugh about Kevin Hart at right. one point when
he's like, yeah. I'm shorter than Kevin Hart or something like that. Wasn't he?
Yeah, they could have used. I mean, I feel like really the only thing they did was that Michael B. Jordan see, which was great.
Oh my God, I'm so glad you brought that up.
It both hurt me and made me so happy at the same time, because it was this, I don't want them to do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Okay, you did it right. That's okay. You can do it that way.
Dude, that was my favorite part of the entire movie, because it was so like, no, they're going to bring Michael Jordan to this one. No way. And then I saw like the silhouette and I was like, that's not him.
Yeah.
That's not him.
And LeBron even like became a fan. Like, he got all googly eyed. Like, oh my God, I'm going to see Jordan. And Michael B. Jordan, thank you for that. Thank you for doing that. Because when they brought up Michael Jordan, I was like, I wonder if they're going to do Michael B. Jordan. Because I've always, unfortunately, kind of looked at the two and I thought it was a funny, you know, comparison. That was a great scene. That was well done.
That was definitely my favorite. That was I wish they kind of would have. I guess they couldn't really do much more with that. There's all these cameos with it.
As much as you want to do.
Right. I think they could have dialed back on the cameos too. Like, they already had so many with like all the Warner Brothers movies. But like, okay, like instead of having just little bits of these good actors, throw a good actor in there.
Yeah, make someone an actual protagonist type character, like, you know, give them an arc, give them a reason to be there. But big difference, original Looney Tunes, you can dig a hole and get there.
Yeah,
here you have to go through that server verse you have to go through that little it reminded me of Terminator.
Yeah,
like, you know, this big sphere that appears, and like, there's no way to really reach the world without being LeBron.
Right.
So there was a disconnect there, and maybe that's why they didn't add the extra character in, or maybe,
you know,
that's why he didn't, you know, actually end up in that world. But I would have loved to see a comedian in there. Like,
so
the interactions would have been great.
You know, the manager, LeBron's manager, the guy that, like,
I don't know the actor's name.
I don't either, but he got like stuck outside of the universe. Yeah. Why didn't they keep him in?
They had a moment there where they could have brought him in, and they were going for a comedic factor with him. Like, he was definitely going to be the Bill Murray.
Right.
And for one reason or another, they didn't go that route, and they sent LeBron's family in instead.
Right, and like,
you could have switched that and sent him in without the family.
Right, have him be like a coach or whatever, and like, you know, he gets to be funny and silly. He gets to toy with the toons, and he's kind of freaking out because he's like, he wanted to be there. You could tell that he was like so upset that he wasn't there. And then,
how'd you lose LeBron?
Yeah, right. And like, yeah, they tried to keep it like funny, and I think that's where they went with the comic relief. But I think they would have, it would have gone so much smoother if they, he was there, because like, you need that, you need that like silly humanity. I mean, they did have it with like Bugs and the
Toons. I think the Looney Tunes were better in the new one than they were previously. I liked the writing for their characters more, because they were trying to make a familiar audience happy to see them on screen.
Right.
While also trying to bring in this new audience. And I don't know if Looney Tunes got canceled for a while. I don't know enough about them, but I know that they're back now. And I'm curious if this was a real big push to try to get kids on board, right, to start watching them again. And I hope, you know, I hope it does go that route, because growing up with that, Looney Tunes are great. It's, yeah, fun. It's the reason I'm wearing a Toon Squad jersey.
Right? Yeah, it was great. I loved that world. I enjoyed it so much. It was so funny. Porky Pig rap.
The rap scene that brought me down a little bit.
Really?
It was like a bittersweet moment for me, though, because I hated what they did and how they did it,
mm-hmm,
but it was also hilarious at the same, right, time. So it was one of those, like, I don't know if I love it or hate it. I just kind of let it be and leave it alone. Right. But it worked. It did work. And it
was funny. It was clever. The thing that I liked about it the most is that the rap was actually kind of like good. And then, yeah, and then the ending line was like, that's all, folks. And I was like, oh my God, how did they, that was so good. Right.
Yeah.
That was such, like, that was a bar. Like, that was fire. Like, they did that so good. And I loved that part of it. When I saw that's what made me want to actually see the movie, is I saw that.
Oh, they had a preview for that one?
They had a preview for that.
I'm glad I didn't see that.
Yeah, and I saw
that. It was such a weird moment of like, oh, this is different. I didn't think they'd do this.
Right, because it's like, you know, it's kind of weird. Like Notorious P.I.G., they're trying to make them all gangster. And I thought, I was like expecting it to go in a weird way, but like, it was perfect. I liked it. It was one of my,
Scene worked, as weird as it was. And it's really a whole movie for me, was I wanted to hate it, but for some reason I was enjoying it and I was entertained the whole way through. And that's how that rap battle was.
Right.
It was like, I hate this idea, but it works.
Yeah.
I don't know why I'm enjoying this right now.
Right. And I think they put a lot of work into like specific scenes like that, but it was like,
you could see where the money went.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You definitely could.
So, I mean, I guess I would say definitely go see it. Like, it's nostalgic. It's like, this is a good movie, but
it's fun. It's just, unfortunately, we're going to compare it to the original. And
right.
Is this a reboot or is this a sequel? Because they never really told us.
Right.
And I like that it was open-ended. Obviously, to the Toons, it was a sequel, but to everyone else, it wasn't.
Yeah.
And I thought that was clever and a different way to do it.
Right. And I think that was kind of like the nostalgia play, because we know who the Looney Tunes, yep, are. The younger generation doesn't. And so I think it was nice. It was clever. So
yeah.
I would definitely suggest seeing the movie, but like, I think they should go into it with your mentality of being,
this is
like,
gonna be awful.
Exactly, because like, I was
dumpster
like,
fire here.
I was so excited. I was like, this is gonna be sick.
I was excited leading up to it.
Yeah.
It was as weird as this might sound, I was actually watching reviews from a Suns game that had happened, and I think it was Skip and Shannon that were tearing apart that LeBron wanted to do this and how it's gonna destroy his legacy and all this stuff. And I was like, this movie is gonna be awful, but I do want to see if there's any good in it.
Right.
And I think that is why I walked away and I saw the good parts and was like, no, he did a good job for what he had.
Right.
And it definitely does not destroy his legacy or change anything. Like, I don't think it affected that at all. I could be wrong. I thought it was spot on for him.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, for what it was, they did great.
As a movie, I give it like a 4 out of 10. It's not very good.
No.
But as a fan and entertainment factor, I mean, it jumps up a couple points. 6, I would... very hard to put it up to like a 7, but like, it does go up a few points for entertainment factor if you're to ignore that you want a real movie, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, that you want character development, you want a proper plot. If you ignore that and just go for entertainment, it was great.
Yeah,
they did a good job.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's what movies are today a lot, like those like popular movies. It's like they're trying to reach the broadest audience.
Yep.
And so like, I get it. And it's like the fast food of movies. It's mm-hmm. It's
well,
great.
What's kind of funny is the music industry has become similar in that, like, when I'm writing lyrics with no refills, we'll sometimes dumb things down and make them a little bit broader because we realize like, this exact experience I had is so unique that it's going to be hard to relate to.
Totally.
And movies are the same way. They're trying to bring, you know, everyone together to enjoy what those writers, directors, you know, what they're feeling. They want everyone to be able to feel that. And it's a really hard thing to find the middle ground of making it what you want and making right. it enjoyable for everyone else.
Right. And yeah, there needs to be that balance. And I just wish that they would not try so hard to, like, I want to make it consumable for everybody. Just, like, make it more relatable, but then, you know, still keep that, like, cleverness.
Yeah.
You know?
Jerseys, what do you think were better?
The original jerseys were sick, but the shoes, they had this perfect little spot where they were like, they did the, it was exactly like a shoe promo, like very low shot. It's like
you, Nike.
Yeah. And the shoes were so sick. They're going to make so much money selling those shoes. I'm the same way.
I like that they did big Nike advertising. I mean, you saw it the minute that LeBron dropped into Toon World with the Nike logo. Yeah. That was what really started the, oh, this is going to be a big advertisement now.
Right.
But no, that the shoes were great. I agree with that. The jerseys, they work with where the NBA is right now.
Right.
And I see what they did and why. But, like, this is a special jersey.
Yeah. Right.
It's a classic. You could have kept them. And the Toons did have them on throughout the movie.
Right.
They had the white ones on, which was cool to see.
Right. So I hate to do this, dude. We got to pause. I'm going to literally piss myself. Like, I'm trying so hard not to pee right now. I was losing focus so hard at the end, though, because I was like, I can't, like, literally.
That's why that was right. I peed right before coming in, because I knew that was going to happen to me.
Just passing it through. Oh, man, that was very satisfying, though. Holy shit.
It's very funny to have a very negative review of a movie, but be able to talk positive about it.
Yeah, because, like, I didn't necessarily, like, love the movie, but, like, it definitely had parts that I really enjoyed. I wouldn't watch it. Okay, maybe it's because, like, I'm an adult now, but, like, as a kid, I always wanted to keep watching Space Jam, but
I unfortunately watched it twice. I watched it the morning that it came out. I woke up and was like, I got time to kill. I'm gonna watch this.
Right.
And then my wife got home from work and wanted to watch it too, of course. So I was like, naturally, I'm gonna sit down and watch this a second time. And
right.
I'm gonna pick it apart for what it is now.
Right.
And that's when I realized it wasn't that bad of a movie. Like, it was okay.
Yeah, I mean, for what it was, for what it is, like, you can't
the first. I liked it a lot more the first time, though. I enjoyed it the first time, and then the second part, I was like, it was okay.
I think the second time around, I would definitely be like, ugh. Like, I don't. But I would have more fun picking it apart.
Yeah, and that was fun for me. I mean, I got to do that with all the Marvel TV shows out. I got to do that with each episode, is I would watch it alone, and then Lauren would get home from work,
nice.
And I would watch it with her. So it was like, I got to watch it knowing what was going to happen.
Right.
And looking for Easter eggs and things like that, instead of waiting and being confused and be like, oh my God, what's going on?
Right. I really like, I want to go back and watch WandaVision, just the first half.
I loved WandaVision.
I really enjoyed it for the...
From someone who appreciates cinematography and, like, writing, I thought it was so well done.
Right, because, like, it was so engaging in the beginning, and then, like, you get... It was still a good story, but, like, I loved the direction they were going. It was so mysterious. You had no idea what was going on, and I was like...
You had ideas, but all of your ideas were wrong.
Right.
Like, that's what I loved about that series.
Right, it was... Yeah.
They faked you out so much.
And see, like, you need a little bit of that actual good, mysterious writing, like... Maybe what do you think would make Space Jam better?
Okay. I mean, obviously adding the extra comedian would be huge, but I almost want to say taking LeBron out of the spotlight and picking a kid who can act and putting him in as the protagonist, having him the character arc of, oh, my dad got sucked into this world and I want to go save him. How do I do it? And having Don Cheadle be like, you can do it by playing on my team. And then that him be manipulating him that way.
Right.
That would have been cool.
That would have been
different approach.
Great,
and then you could have seen an actor act
instead
of a basketball player attempting to act.
Right. Because
there's so many things that you can do with that type of story.
Yeah. Add a little bit more mystery.
I think they were just afraid to piss off fans who wanted the nostalgia. I do think that was a big part.
Yeah.
And anytime you do a reboot or a sequel, you do have to look at the original and make sure that you're appropriate with the source material.
Yeah, right, right. But yeah, I think if they could have added a little bit more mystery to algorithm too, I think that would have been interesting.
Like, yeah, or add anything to him.
Right. Like have him
maybe
somehow...
make him a real person somehow that got in there or something, or like someone behind the computer running the serververse who's not actually physically in there as like a fake character.
Ooh, like what if there was somebody, so like young son has an amazing idea, makes this incredible video game, and then somebody tries to steal it, and then like somehow they get trapped in this virtual world. Like, yeah, like it make it. I just give it a little
How
bit more.
How was that the pitch you went with? I know you got tons of different Space Jam sequel pitches over the last 20 years.
Yeah.
How is that the one you went with?
Right. That's because they probably were able to make a lot of money in the sense that, like, oh, we get to now just, like, advertise all of our killer movies. We get to like, have now, like, a new brand and, like, a new way to sell Space Jam or like whatever Warner Brothers stuff that they wanted to push movie.
They got to push anything they wanted.
It's like they tried to pull the Disney card of like, oh, we're going to make a new one so we can sell all these toys.
Yeah, I'm really surprised we didn't get a coming soon Warner Brothers streaming service.
Yeah, right.
Which is probably coming soon. They'll probably call it Warner Brothers 3000.
Again, I really enjoyed the experience of watching it. I didn't really enjoy the movie itself, but like everything that went with it was pretty good.
Yeah, it was entertaining, but not a good movie.
Well, there you have it, folks. Go try it out. See what you think. And
hopefully you've already seen it before watching this.
I know, right? Seriously. Go look at it with these rose-colored glasses. Where can we follow you? Where can we find your stuff?
What's really funny is anytime before probably this week, I would have said, go on Facebook and come stalk us, hang out with us. But we're finally a little bit more active on Instagram now, and we're having fun on there posting photos and videos and stuff. So that's a little bit more where the action is. If you want our music, Spotify and YouTube is where it's at.
And are you guys releasing a new EP, or did that just get released? Or what's
Tyler's not here. We get some spoilers. All right. Ooh. So this is when I get into trouble. That's why I don't do this stuff alone. So we came out with our EP last year knowing it was a part A, that we had more to go. And we're recording the second half of it this year.
Nice.
So how we're going to release it, I don't know. If we're going to do like an A side, B side, or a separate EP altogether. Mm-hmm. But they do tie in pretty closely with what we just did. We will be recording it by the end of the year. So as far as release date,
still kind of up in the
air. You guys an idea. We recorded that EP last summer and it came out January 1st. So I'm hoping for a similar timeline.
Nice.
And then we'll be hitting the stage again in October. We have a private show coming up. So if you want to come, email me, bug me, hit us up on Facebook, Instagram, whatever it is. Ask us where to go because it will not be well advertised. It's a little bit of a secret show. These guys will be coming.
Yeah, we're coming. And on Instagram, it's at No Refills Band, right?
No Refills Band, yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, throw them some DMs. You can follow us at Don't Drink N, like just the letter N and review. So follow us on Instagram as well. Got anything else you want to say?
Can we end it with that awful LeBron dab?
He dabbed? What? Was,
he's like, Dad, don't dab. And he's like, and dab. And he leaves the room.
Yeah. Awful LeBron dab on 3, 2, 1. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky.